Started. Welcome to the second panel of our first day of the third annual Claro Conference. We have also the Claro's fifth edition is on the table, and feel free to pick up a copy. It is very thick this year, so we had limited copies, so please only take one if you do plan to use it, but if you do plan to use it, please do take one. It's also going to be available online. I'll show you our updated website really quickly. Have you guys seen Red Rock's calendar, how it's a clickable, interactive PDF? That's what's going on with Claro now. So if you'll see, you can click around in here. And on the website, on this page, we have a table of contents. And at the very bottom, there's some online-only content, such as videos, Prezi's, websites. And so that's where you can access some of that material. Otherwise, all of the papers that will be presented are going to be in that print journal that you saw over here. We've updated our submission guidelines. So for you students and instructors in the room, do check in with the new guidelines on how to submit your work. Claro is becoming more and more competitive every year that goes by. And so make sure you submit correctly when you submit. If you ever get that A++ on a paper, tell your instructor to submit it. There are about 20 instructors at Red Rocks who are super behind Claro. They know about Claro. They're regularly submitting to Claro. And then about, how many instructors do we have here? About 100 full-timers? 120? And so the rest of them, I think, still go, Claro? What's Claro? And so for some of you, your best chance to get published is to let your instructors know we exist, okay? So this is going to come from the ground up. So do publicize this and let people know it's here and it's a resource. And I hope to see some of you published in Claro next year. I think those are all the announcements I have to make. So I might hand it over to our first presenter. I'm going to let our presenters introduce themselves to you. But today's panel is all themed around ethical eats. And so these are all sort of ethical questions with our food consumption and our food creation. And so I'm looking forward to a lively session of Q&A after you've all presented us your materials.
Hi, my name is Hannah Thomas. Thank you all for coming. So how many of you are sick and tired of being told what to eat and what to avoid like the plague? We hear it all the time in the news, the media, and even when we're innocently browsing the web. Unsolicited articles pop up warning us of the dangers of this, that, and the other thing. The amount of information has become overwhelming and, quite frankly, obnoxious. I think a lot of people have gotten to the point where we just throw our hands in the air and say, I give up. I'm going to eat what I can get, what I can afford, and hope for the best. Oh, I should probably get this back up. It's OK. Anyways, well, I was in the same boat not too long ago. But that all changed for me when I enrolled in a class with Dr. Elizabeth Stearns. She's right here. Awesome teacher. I highly recommend her. In that class, I was forced against my will to come face to face with topics that have come to be known as food politics. In that class, twice a week, we would discuss both sides of many fences, the pros and cons of different solutions to food issues, and what we could just do in our everyday lives to be more aware of the situation. Because the fact of the matter is that we do have some pretty serious food problems in our country. And I think a lot of that stems from the general public just being ill-informed. But the bright side is that the information is out there. We might just have to dig a little to find it. There's a number of topics concerning food issues in our country that we could talk about today, but I want to focus on one in particular, and that is being more aware of where your food comes from and the ingredients that are in your food, oftentimes that shouldn't be. For me, this process of realizing that when it comes to food, oftentimes there's more than what meets the eye, started when Dr. Stearns assigned a research essay in which we were to discuss a favorite food, explain a little bit why it was special to us, and then do some research and find out the journey that food makes from the very beginning until when it ends up on the table. I ended up choosing Chipotle, a locally started chain restaurant I'm sure most of you are familiar with. In the beginning of the company, Steve Ells, the founder, noticed that the carnitas, the slow-roasted pork, wasn't really selling, and he wanted to know why. So he took a trip down to the farm that the company was originally sourcing their pork from. And when he got there, he was horrified. The pigs destined to be in the carnitas burritos were living in awful conditions. They were in a crowded warehouse, so much so that they couldn't even move or walk around, knee-deep in their own filth, in basically a warehouse, no windows. It was dark. They were scared. It was really bad. And we could go on about poor treatment of animals as far as, you know, factory farming and major food corporations, but that is another presentation for another day. The point is that Ells decided right then and there to make some changes and to be aware of where the food that was going to end up in his restaurant was coming from. Today, Chipotle has unbelievably strict guidelines as far as who's dealing with their food and where it comes from. I actually have a friend who works for Chipotle, and she was telling me how just recently it was discovered that a pork supplier was not meeting these standards. And as soon as they found that out, they pulled the carnitas from the line company-wide and basically just set a sign out that said, we've noticed that the pork isn't up to standard. And I think that's pretty awesome that they did that. Some of you might be wondering, you know, if these pigs are just going to end up in a burrito anyways, then what does it really matter, you know, how they're treated? But you've likely heard the phrase, you are what you eat. And maybe another way to think about it is, if you had witnessed the living conditions of these pigs firsthand, scared and dirty and in the dark, would it change your mind? Would you still look at them and say, yeah, I'd eat that? For Steve Ells, the answer was a resounding no. And that decision and the actions that followed is how Chipotle's slogan, Food with Integrity, came to be the phrase the company lives by. I would like to clarify that my goal today is not to give you a food complex, nor is it to tell you what to do. My hope is to encourage and maybe even inspire you to just know a little bit more about what you put into your bodies and to think twice before food purchasing decisions. If not for a concern for your own health, then maybe instead for the health of the kids in our lives. And again, some of you might be thinking that this whole food topic has been blown out of proportion, and that might be true to an extent. Even so, I wanted to give you a couple of examples of ingredients found in everyday food items that might surprise you. Lovely picture. A trick often employed by major food corporations through clever marketing and packaging schemes is deceiving consumers about what they're really getting. For instance, when you think about buying chicken breast from the grocery store, you think that's pretty cut and dry. It's a one ingredient item. You can see it in the packaging. Seems pretty safe. However, you might not be aware, as I was not until recently, that oftentimes these chicken breasts, among other packaged meats, are injected with salt water. Doesn't sound like a big deal at first, but it is for a couple reasons. One, they do this to add weight to the item. So you end up paying more for the weight of salt water than for chicken. Secondly, diets high in sodium lead to a number of health problems, high blood pressure probably being one of the most notable. And these meats injected with salt water contain up to 5 times the normal amount of sodium, which is just pretty gross. And it's dishonest. A couple ways you can check for this is by reading the label. And I encourage you to always, always read the label of food that you buy. It might say something like, may contain up to 10% added solution or up to 15% chicken broth, which sounds harmless. And they want it to sound harmless, but it's not. And again, this is one of the reasons why Chipotle is so serious about ethically sourcing their food, because stuff like this happens if you don't pay attention. Okay, moving on. Bisphenol A, commonly referred to as BPA, some of you may have heard the term. It's kind of been buzzworthy in the media in the last couple of years. It's a chemical that, until recently, was used to line hard plastic materials like Nalgene bottles, sippy cups, baby bottles, things like that. Thankfully, they don't do this any longer, as far as we know. You might be wondering or thinking that I don't often find myself eating hard plastic, so what's the point of bringing this up? Well, in a study conducted in 2010, recently published in Environment International, a group of scientists collected 204 convenience food items from stores in Dallas, Texas. These were an assortment of fresh, frozen, and canned foods. They took a sample from each food and ran them through a series of tests. They did this for two rounds, and what they found is pretty scary. 73% of canned foods contain BPA. Now, BPA, or exposure to it, can result in interference with normal brain functioning, prostate problems, especially in fetuses and young children, which is really scary, low thyroid, effects on the female reproductive system, and various forms of cancer, just from exposure to food that has been packaged in cans. So the best way to avoid this is to just avoid eating canned foods as much as possible. Again, my goal was not to give you a gloom and doom presentation today, and there is an upside to all of this, and that is that we have the choice to make more informed food buying decisions. And that decision to do so is up to you. I know it seems like most of us are too busy in our day-to-day lives to spend time researching every little food ingredient, but here's the thing. We are living in an age of convenience. How many of you have a smartphone? Most, a lot of us. So that's just unlimited access to information at your fingertips within seconds, depending on the Wi-Fi, of course. And I encourage you to use that access of information to empower yourselves to make more informed food purchasing decisions. Next time you're at the grocery store, maybe just take a few seconds to read the label. And if there's something listed that you don't know or never heard of, look it up. You know, do the research and decide for yourself. And don't let the media and the companies who are just after your money make those decisions for you. To wrap things up today, I wanted to leave you with a few resources to help get you started. So these are apps, since most of us do have smartphones. It's really easy to just download an app. Most of them are free, maybe like $3 to $5 at the very most, which I think is a pretty decent price to avoid some serious health problems down the line. The first one, MyFoodFacts, is used primarily to discern whether or not food allergens are present in food items. A lot of people have food allergies, so this is really helpful. But I mention it because it also brings up, if you scan a food, the barcode, it brings up a list of easily searchable ingredients. So it's a really good resource. The second app is called Chemical Cuisine, and this one was actually developed by the Center for Science in the Public Interest. It sends their food additive safety ratings directly to the device. I like this one too because it's a color-coded system, ranging from green, meaning safe, yellow means cut back, orange means caution, and then red is completely avoid. Might be surprising to know on their website, caramel coloring, which is in almost everything that we eat, is made from ammonia and sulfites, so it is on their red do not eat list. The next is Fooducate. It was voted the top best health and fitness app of 2011. Again, you can just scan barcodes, and the app provides honest evaluations of ingredients and product safety. Lastly, What's on My Food? It's an extensive list of foods that are likely to be treated with pesticides and harmful chemicals that have been linked to ADHD, autism, and certain cancers. So good stuff to know. And then a few websites, easy to navigate, same thing. What's on My Food, just tons of information about food treated with pesticides. The Center for Science and Public Interest, mentioned before, their Chemical Cuisine app. Their website is awesome, easy to navigate. They've got the color-coded ranking system. So these are just a few resources to kind of help get you started. Most of them are free, like I said. And if you're interested in finding out more about this topic, I suggest just doing a simple internet search because, you know, there's a lot of resources out there to help you make more informed food buying decisions. So thank you all for your time, and I hope that was helpful.
Thank you so much, Hannah. I actually saw some people in the audience getting on their smartphones, but not because you were boring them, but because they needed to go find out about these apps. So thank you so much. If you have any questions, make sure to save them for the end. We're going to go ahead and go to our next presentation now. And again, I'll let you introduce yourself and your topic.
Hello, everybody. Thank you all for coming. My name is Rachel Rockenfeller, and I wrote a paper this semester, or last spring, about genetically modified foods and how they affect our health. And I think this is a really important topic for today, because last election, even, we had a question that we had to vote on concerning genetically modified foods. So I was interested when writing this paper, are they good? Are they safe? What will the costs be? And in my research, I found a lot of surprising details. So here, let me just get that in. Hold on just one second. Sometimes it takes a moment to recognize your desk. Did you just put it in? Yeah. Okay. Sorry, we're having technical difficulties.
It's on your computer.
Oh.
Should be on your computer.
Computer?
Yeah.
Oh, that was it.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
Okay, there you go.
All right. Whoa, what just happened?
Just put slideshow on the top. Go back to where you're.
Oh,
I'm sorry. Sorry.
Oh. Yes.
So
just navigating.
Okay, so
it's down.
Yeah, right there. So this
trick
or treat. Got it. Okay.
Yes.
And do you know how to put it on slideshow? Slideshow from beginning,
yeah.
And then you can use that little clicker on the top to go back and forth.
Cool. Thank you. All right. So what I found was, what I wanted to see first was the increase in the production of these and why. Why did they increase? And to answer this, I found that, for one thing, they were advertised as being able to prevent disease by splicing genes in there that prevented cancer or liver disease. You could prevent diseases. Also, they have a much larger crop yield. So a farmer can create twice as much product as he could in the past. And this is really helpful because, as one of my sources found, GMOs have the potential to help prevent world hunger by giving more crop yields for the same work as previous crops. And he goes on to later say that, I always find it depressing to hear citizens of developed countries rail against the supposed evils of GMOs from the luxury of their air-conditioned living rooms, while a farmer in the developing world would likely donate an arm for GMO crop if it's going to bring him greater yields and put food on his family's table. So it's not just greater yields. These are feeding families. And as you can see, their increase was tremendous when these findings came out. This is since 2000, and as you can see, at about 2001, they just skyrocketed up. And now they have finally reached their place of a bunch of stuff being used for all sorts of different purposes. 98% of genetically modified soy goes to feeding animals and fueling cars. 79.5% of genetically modified corn goes to the same process, and what's left goes to the use of basic ingredients like what you would see in your condiments, basically cornstarch, corn syrup, cottonseed oil, canola oil, soybean oil, that sort of thing. But a lot of it is actually used for cars and animals, despite us being told that they're used for human. But when I found that out, I was even more curious to know, why are they so, what is the conflict that arises from these foods? Are they dangerous or are they not? So I dug a little further, and my research was difficult because most sources are not necessarily reliable. They like to attack each other. So I went through and had to be a little careful, but what I found was that both sides agreed that chemicals are bad. They're harmful. So I looked into what they said, and they conflict on whether or not GM foods require greater numbers, but I found that these chemicals can cause birth defects, cancer, endocrine disruption, damage to DNA, reproductive and development damage in mammals. This is really scary because in the whole study thing, they found that a whole bunch of these animals developed huge tumors. Their children had multiple problems, and it was really frightening. And then, these are really scary because some sources say they've increased. And which brings me to another scary fact, is what happens with the corn since the food has also increased. With corn, there were associations with organ damage, blood cell formation, and mortality rates in animals studied. One example of the mortality rates was scientists observed that when they fed chickens GMO corn, that the chickens would suddenly die. And that was strange to them because according to what was publicized, this should not happen. But there's a lot of evidence suggesting that it could. And then there was one human study conducted a couple years ago. And in this study, they found that humans eating a genetically modified food, they saw that the GMO DNA was spontaneously transferred out of the food and into the DNA of the human's gut bacteria, which they speculate causes a hybrid of a genetically modified cell, in which case we would all have been genetically modified. They also theorized that the genetically modified promoters of the cell, and I'm sure you all know what that is. I didn't, so I researched it, but it's a switch that activates the cell. So say a virus, if it is activated on, it is a threat to the human health. And so they theorize that these genetically modified promoters can turn on these dormant cells and cause disease. And then they also theorize that genetically modified food traces can be passed to humans through the dairy and meat they eat. And so this is definitely a pretty frightening subject. And so, and then also, just realized this. Back to the chemicals, there's not just the whole getting it on your skin or anything. There's also the breathing. And in my research, I found this article that told this very compelling story of a mother in Argentina. And they lived near a genetically modified soy crop, and the planes were spraying the fields, and her baby had turned blue, and the mother was suffering from respiratory problems. So it's not just the whole scary cancer birth defect thing. It's also, it can cause respiratory problems, and there's no telling if these are permanent or not. Like I said, there are still a lot of speculations. So, but yes, it's pretty crazy. And then that's what they've seen past. So, yeah. So, are these foods dangerous? Well, studies conducted by pro-GMO activists have proven it's impossible for genetically modified DNA to integrate with that of humans. And so basically, they're saying that it's impossible for these anti-GMO groups to have any credit to their findings because it's very unlikely that any DNA could be absorbed from these plants. And then nature has altered the genetic makeup of a plant throughout history. It has been constant changing. I mean, in history this semester, I've been learning that ancient civilizations would purposely breed plants to make a new hybrid that would better grow, better feed a population. And this is very, very interesting. However, today we have the technology to make these changes rapid and really quickly and severely. Also, the FDA will not allow genetically modified foods to enter the market unless they pass all of the safety tests. So they should be safe. Next is pollination. This is another ground that both sides agree on. Green America found that studies performed on animals showed that genetically modified corn, So pollination is a huge agreement. Both sides agree that pollination is a problem and that genetically modified pollination or genes can be transferred via bees to organic crops and therefore contaminating all of the surrounding crops in our society. So what was thought that was not genetically modified is now genetically modified. However, there's hope because organic foods are not supposed to contain any more than a small, small percentage. So that is encouraging. So despite what all the propaganda about them being bad or good is, we honestly don't know. They could be bad, they could be good, we don't know, but I firmly believe that we should continue studying these plants because they do serve a purpose. People in third world countries often depend on these foods to help sustain their lives and keep their families fed. So, but honestly, what are the benefits if there's cancer or your children develop weird diseases? So, with that being said, I firmly believe that we need to study these more, and maybe even several generations worth of studying. So to wrap up, I have handouts if you would like to learn more about this. And thank you all for coming, and thank you for putting up with my lack of speaking. So thank you all.
Well, if we didn't have a food complex before, we might be developing one. Let's see if Dakota's gonna further that or not. I'll let you introduce yourself as well.
All right. Well, my name is Dakota Sorensen. I'm currently a sophomore at the University of Colorado Denver. I attended Red Rocks Community College for my whole freshman semester and half of my sophomore year. This paper began as my English Composition 2 final research essay titled "Eating More: Are We Supporting the Economy or Making It Worse?" I didn't really give much thought to this essay at first, but in the process of writing, by doing some preliminary research, I realized that there's this huge gap between what the government spends on obesity care and what it spends trying to prevent obesity altogether. In 2005, the American government spent $190 billion on obesity and obesity-related diseases. In 2006, obesity alone was responsible for more than 10% of all medical costs. Not to mention the prevalence of obesity is so great that 35% of adults age 20 and over are obese. Age 20 and over is the dark blue bar here. You can see that it's fairly even across the board. Same for children ages 2 through 9, except with a little more diversity. Children have a 17% obesity rate, and it continues to rise for all demographics. Jumping right in, what do you guys like to eat? Would you prefer to eat fruit salad and energy drinks every day? Or would you rather have some bacon and a Hershey chocolate bar? You might be thinking, I should go with the healthier choice. But what your taste buds say is different. Your mouth might have started to water when I said bacon, because that is a food you enjoy. Now, being college students, you guys probably just eat whatever is cheap and readily available. Nothing really wrong with that. However, you guys would and could eat healthier if you had the time and spare change. But there are people who just do not have the choice to eat a healthier diet. And unfortunately, it is often single parents who have one or more children to feed as well. When a child is hungry, what do? Do you look them in the eye and say, "You're fine. You ate yesterday"? No, you probably give them something to eat. But with a constricted budget, you can only fill the pantry with cheap and inexpensive food. And that brings us to our first issue. Food stamps are too darn worthless. How much do you guys think the average food stamp benefit is for one person per day? Any guesses? $7 a day? Any other guesses?
50 cents.
50 cents? You're shooting it low. The average food stamp benefit for one person per day is $4.20. I know college students who spend that amount of money on one cup of coffee every day. As you can see, some typical meals of a college student. I don't know about you, but if I only had about $5 to eat, to buy food every day, I would eat a lot of, what, McDonald's, Wendy's, Burger King, fast food places that offer super cheap deals so we eat their amalgamation of strange foods. And their food is almost addictive. Borrowing the Jim Jaffigan joke, has your mother ever made anything as good as a McDonald's fry? If she did, I wouldn't look like this. So food stamps just don't pay the bills. And believe it or not, they're trying to reduce the number of people on food stamps. 7 million of those people don't have another source of a reliable income. The American government only spent $75.7 billion on food stamp distribution, and they reduced that. In 2013, they cut back the food stamp benefit money given to households by about $5 billion. Going back to the single parent, let's say a single mother with two kids, she has less than $12.60 to feed them breakfast, lunch, and dinner. The next issue is that healthy eating is often pricey and inconvenient. What you're seeing, oops. There it is. It's out of order. What you're seeing now is a list of recommended serving sizes of fruits and vegetables, of which I do not meet in any way. Male, 20 years old, I should have about 3.5 cups of vegetables. Pretty sure I get zero. I went to the store recently and bought a pack of 4 mandarin orange cups for about $1.89. Each cup contained about 6 itty-bitty little orange slices, and even after eating them, the cup was still 3/4 of the way full of juice. I felt a little ripped off, especially considering I had to poke holes in the top of it to drain some of the juice out, because I couldn't open it without it exploding. So I'll ask you guys, in your opinion and experience, do you think the price of eating healthy foods, such as fruits and vegetables, is expensive or affordable? Who says expensive? A couple people. Who says affordable? Okay. Interesting. Now, I took the side that it is expensive. The fact of the matter is there is a huge variability in the price of fruits and vegetables, ranging from 26 cents per pound up to $7 per pound. What this is a graph over 26 years of the price index of fruits and vegetables as compared to the price index of cupcakes, cakes, and cookies. You can see that fruits and vegetables got really expensive fairly quickly, whereas junk food stayed fairly inexpensive. Going back to the serving sizes, you can be a bargain hunter and only buy the cheapest fruits and vegetables. But what if you have a kid, and what if that kid doesn't like these cheap fruits and vegetables? What if they want the most expensive kind? Because you know, kids are picky like that. And there's a direct correlation between the price of fruits and vegetables and how often people eat them, even. States with the lowest fruit and vegetable consumption show the highest obesity rates in America. But you can be proud of this, Colorado is the skinniest state. So let's keep it that way. Now I know I can't make anyone eat healthier or change what foods they enjoy, because people will eat however they want. But if someone wants to eat healthy and can't, that's where I want to help. The simplest change that we can make is to either increase SNAP funding or make fruits and vegetables more accessible to low-income communities. How can we do that? Well, the government can affect how we act, and we can affect the government. I know some people think the government interferes too much already, but sometimes it's just a necessary evil. We also need to make farmers markets more available to low-income communities, or even create community gardens at schools. We can also always just change ourselves and set an example for other people. And lastly, we can simply just tell a friend. Tell other people about the problems surrounding obesity, what it costs to treat, and what we can do to avoid it. Knowledge is power, and the more we know about something, the more we can do to prepare for it. My name has been Dakota Sorensen, and I thank you for listening to my presentation.
Thank you so much to all our presenters. Can we give them all another round of applause? And so at this point, we're going to open it up to questions from the audience. And comments, even, if you want to just give them a comment on their presentation. Who would like to go first? And I'll be bringing the mic to you. And please do wait until you have the mic to ask your question, because the mic is going directly into our recording. And if you speak without the mic, your question may not be picked up on the recording.
Hi, my name is Jacob. I have a question about the first presentation. What do you think the threshold is for taking those harmful substances out of the food, like lead out of gasoline? Back in the 60s or whenever they did that, they're like, oh, this is so bad, we gotta take it out. Is there a threshold? I mean, it seems like it's already pretty bad.
That's a difficult question to answer. And I think a lot of, BPA lining plastic bottles and cans and things, that's been going on for, since food has been canned, and it's just recently coming to the forefront, you know? And so I think a lot of people think, well, we've been eating this way for so long, it doesn't really seem to be affecting anything. I think only time will tell. It's just the whole topic of food politics is very, you're either on one side or the other, and it's hard to find common ground, I think, is the biggest problem with it.
Could we get the other presenters to also sort of respond to this just general concept of threshold or tipping point? Or
I definitely agree that food is definitely a topic of debate, and there is so much controversy no matter where you look that it's very hard to pick just one side. Both have very valid reasons for supporting what they do. I think time it will only tell.
Can you maybe state the question in another way?
Yeah, what do you mean? Do you mean tipping point? Explain.
Yeah, like tipping point, like when after a certain amount of damage had been done with lead and gasoline and environmental effects of that, they realized, oh, this is actually bad. Like, we need to do something. So how many people have to get cancer from canned food before,
right.
I don't know, it's like a legislative.
Well, I think it has to do, I mentioned, the general public is just really ill-informed. A lot of these topics just, they don't want you to know, because then you might stop buying their product. So I think it has a lot to do with, we need to talk about it more, like Dakota was saying, spread the knowledge that you have to the people that you know, and just get more people behind, making changes.
I'll ask the next question, and I'll ask it of Dakota. Can you review for us, so when I was reading all of these for publication in Claro and editing them, the thing that struck me most about your work was the vast gap in how much we pay for obesity, disease, and illness treatment versus how much money we put into the sorts of programs that would prevent this. Can you just review for us? It was how many billion versus how many million?
So obesity was $190 billion, and food stamp funding was only $75.7 billion, and they reduced that by $5 billion.
Million, you mean? Or no, billion?
It's billion.
Okay. Great. So half or less, right? That seems like the kind of information that if we had, we would be making perhaps different choices. So I think we have another question right here.
So I actually have a question for each person on the panel, if that's okay to eat up a bunch of time. So my question for the first presenter is, like you were saying, BPA was super buzzworthy, and it's kind of like you can go back each year and find that one thing. So how do you propose, because I'm super skeptical of big companies, how do you propose, like, so they quit using BPA, how can you stay sure that they're not just like, okay, well, we're not using BPA, we're not using this certain chemical anymore, but we're gonna start calling it by a different name, and then it takes a while for the consumers to catch on and be like, well, wait, you're doing it again.
Yeah.
So how is a good way to?
I don't know that you can. I mean, I think that's just the world that we are living in, unfortunately. You have to do the research and make your own decisions about it. And as far as BPA in particular, what I found in my research, the best way to avoid it, because who knows if they're going to be honest about it, is to just steer clear. Like, that's why a lot of people are drinking out of glass water bottles these days. A lot of companies have started, instead of using cans, they'll package their food in, like, cardboard. So if you go to the grocery store, look for soups that aren't in cans. They're in little cardboard containers. And I think that's the best that we can do right now, because they're just trying to make money is the bottom line. Unfortunately, they're not really worried about us little right. people, you know.
Okay, and then my question for the second one was, you had posted something on your PowerPoint about, you know, the FDA requires certain levels of testing, and again, like I said, I am super skeptical of food companies. So how is the common person supposed to trust in the FDA when the head of the FDA is, you know, he used to be a corporate leader for Monsanto, who's the company who's producing all the GMOs? So it's like, how can we repair the trust, and how can I believe in what the FDA is saying?
Yeah, I had a similar question while I was researching. And to be honest, it's hard to trust them. But also the studies being conducted against genetically modified foods, a lot of them are also very, very biased. And they're not looking at it skeptically. Some seem to treat this whole subject as kind of a political war rather than a cause for mankind. So I totally get what you're saying, and again, I think only time will tell, to be
honest. It's just interesting because I've done a similar paper, so it's like I can't help but wonder, in like certain graphs and studies, it's like, how far do you have to go to find out who funded that and who funded that person's funding, and so who's really funding it?
Yeah.
But right, and then my last question was, due to obesity and food stamps, and I'm kind of a firm believer in eating healthy is something you have to learn. It's not like you just wake up one day and chard is like the best thing in the world. So my question was, do you have any ideas on how that you could break the cycle and help people discover healthier eating? Because, you know, like the one graph showed that cupcakes stayed the same price, but vegetables went up. But how often are we eating cupcakes for dinner? Or like how can we break the cycle?
I think to break the cycle, we just need to kind of popularize it. You know, get it more into the media, which we are doing a little bit right now. But what do you see commercials for most often? Probably cheeseburgers and fries and all these really kind of disgusting foods. So I think if we can get it into the media more, just kind of spread it around, it'll come to be kind of the accepted popular decision. It'll make you a cool kid.
I have a question that's mostly for the second presentation. I also did a presentation, my high school graduation one, on genetically modified organisms, and I was wondering, because the FDA passes quite a bit of things that are still unhealthy, and so I'm wondering what kind of, if you know, what kind of tests that they run on these to make them passable.
That is kind of a gray area. I think some of them don't want those tests revealed to the public, but it's mostly sounding like it's, they do similar tests on animals or something like that. I'm not really sure. I'm sorry.
Yeah, your research didn't quite go in that direction.
Yeah.
Maybe if someone in the audience is an expert on such a thing, maybe someone could fill us in. But we might move to another question otherwise.
Yeah, I had a question about, for the last two presentations really together. Okay, so you want to increase the amount of healthy food that people eat. However, most of the healthy food that we should eat has GMOs in it. So is it really healthy to eat the healthier food if we still have GMOs in order to increase the amount so we can decrease the price? So if that's gonna happen, then what are we gonna do?
I'd say that as of the GMO thing, it might not be the best choice to go to the grocery store and buy a bunch of carrots and vegetables and fruits and all that, which is why I kind of recommend farmers markets and even community gardens, because then you know exactly where it came from. And I actually have a funny story about the community garden thing. My brother in his sixth grade class brought in some homegrown potatoes, and they asked him why he put dirt on them.
They didn't know they came from the ground.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't know where our food comes from, right?
I definitely agree. I think that farmers markets are wonderful things because you can ask them questions. You know that they brought their own produce, and you can ask them what they did to grow their produce. So I do definitely agree with that statement.
Okay. But it's going to be cheap.
Yeah.
And that's where other point was. We need to make it more accessible to low-income communities.
Because one theory is as demand goes up, price could go down. Other questions or comments?
On one of the slides, there was a picture with organic versus natural. Could someone address that? I read that natural doesn't really mean anything.
Most of those terms don't really mean anything. They're basically, clever packaging schemes. They've caught on to the fact that if you put the word natural on the label, that people are like more likely to buy it because it sounds good. I think the only label that has any meaning is USDA approved. That's the only one that's government backed. The rest of it is just kind of like pretty labeling. It doesn't really mean anything.
Which is why it's important that people like Steve Ells from your paper actually go and find out.
Exactly.
On the ground, which is why he was so impressive to you, I think.
Yes, absolutely.
I guess I have a question for the second presentation. I guess it's kind of a two-part question. One, are you talking about like GMOs that are selective breeding GMOs or chemically engineered GMOs? Because those are two things. Two different things. And also, you talked about how like there are studies that show that like there isn't necessarily a connection between GMOs like affecting DNA that exists within human beings. But what studies are there, and how do you feel about like some of the evidence that links GMOs to like an increase in autoimmune diseases that have happened in the recent years?
So to your first question, my paper kind of focused on all of them. So there's probably a lot of separation between the two, but mine just kind of focused on the overall. And to your second question, I don't know, to be honest, what it affects today, but definitely there are a lot of international studies going on right now that are revealing a lot of crazy findings.
If you pick up the publication, you can see her exhaustive work cited, and she has some really good sources in there you could track down and look out for yourself as well.
Nice job, kids.
Thank
I've got a question for all three of you. In your research, did you find that the nutrition of the world basically is causing any specific disease trends specifically to our youth, like maybe Asperger's or some of the cancers we see?
I mean, there are definitely links to, you know, highly processed, chemically, you know, produced food, absolutely. I guess I didn't focus on that in particular, but I'm sure there's a lot of information on it out there. But I mean, like Dakota was saying, just obesity alone, some people consider that a disease, you know? So, yeah, definitely links.
Unfortunately, I didn't look too much at the world. I focused more on America. But I do believe we have some of the highest obesity rates in the world. And we also like our cheeseburgers.
Yeah.
So.
Yes, I do.
I unfortunately also did not really look in that aspect, but I also think that right now the whole topic of genetically modified foods is still so young that it's hard to get a lot of significant, credible data on the subject, so.
It's a really heated topic too,
yeah.
So.
I had a question for the first presentation.
You said that Chipotle had changed their standards of their meat. I was wondering if you knew what those standards were now.
Well, they actually, luckily they did that closer to the beginning of when the company came to be, and that was because Steve Ells, the founder, found, you know, he noticed that the meat wasn't really selling, the pork in particular. So right then and there, he just, the guidelines and standards as far as how, you know, the people who he's sourcing those products from, the meats and the produce, how they're raising their food, how they're growing it, how they're producing it, you know, what goes into that process. He likes to know exactly what's going on. And if there's anything unnatural or unethical, he will stop buying from them and find someone else.
As a follow-up to that question, is there any evidence, and it, again, may have been outside the scope of your current research, but I'm just curious to know whether there's any research that the more Steve Ells we have in high and powerful places, if more people are going to jump on that bandwagon, and again, it might relate to the question that came up from this gentleman earlier, if more people are demanding ethically sourced food, if it will mean that there is more of it.
I think so, and I think that that's happening slowly. And in my essay, the actual paper that I wrote, that's kind of how I wrapped my paper up, is that there is a demand for it. People are looking for places that they can eat where they know that their food is healthy. It's clean and healthy food sourced ethically and from farmers who take really good care of their animals and their produce. So I definitely think there's a high demand for it, and I think that Chipotle and Steve Ells is setting the stage for that.
More questions, comments? We have room for about two more questions, I think.
You were talking about how a lot of the GMO products go to animal food and like fuel sources. Mm-hmm. The animals that are eating those GMOs, are we eating those animals?
Yes.
Dang. So then technically we're consuming those GMO plants through the animal, right? And does that,
yes,
as far as like the DNA thing, is that like integrated then into the animal and then to us, or what's the...
That is what's being speculated and studied greatly right now, is they're really concerned about that. So,
and you found sources that directly contradicted each other on that, yeah, point, right, in your essay.
Yeah.
And both of those had some heavy researches backing them, but they both completely contradicted each other, so yes.
Oh, I said they're secondhand GMOs.
On the way over to this guy, I will ask my last question for you guys, which is, it came up in the first panel today too, which is issues of class and economics, you know, playing a role here, because in our first presentation today, we had someone talking about genetic modification of humans and how that could possibly create a caste system, people who have access, people who don't. And some of this really seems to come back to who can afford to eat well and who cannot. And so I feel like all your presentations in some way touched on the economics of food as well. You talking about third world countries and how some of them depend on these higher yield crops. And of course, your situation talking about food stamps and your situation, you know, talking about someone who'll go to Chipotle and pay $8 this burrito with the ethically sourced pork versus just going to Safeway and getting the salt injected or whatever, the pork that's $2 a pound,
right,
or something on sale. So I don't know if you guys have a response to issues of class and class position and money. And then there's the whole thing you didn't even touch on, Dakota, which would be a good part two. Well, maybe you did touch on this, food deserts, right? That there are areas geographically in our country that can't even get to a farmer's market or something like this.
Yes, and food deserts sometimes have the highest prices of fruits and vegetables.
My question is on the GMOs. What do you think about voluntary labeling?
I think that is a wonderful idea. I think it should be supported a lot more than it is today. And
do you think it's a trustable source, or? Because I mean, it's not. There's not any test is done on it. Like, are they doing their own test, or?
That's a good point.
And is it reliable? Like, you never know. It might not be trustable.
If it says organic, it should be reliable, because there's a whole bunch of laws regarding organic foods. But if it goes outside of the organic realm, it's kind of, you kind of have to research the company more.
Right. While they have like the non-GMO what is it, the, I don't know, you know, the label, the non-GMO?
Yeah.
They have that one. I usually go with that one or the organic.